Transition because they came after me trying to do a coup. They came after me spying on my campaign. They started from the day I won and even before I won, from the day I came down the escalator with our first lady. They were a disaster. They were a disgrace to our country. And we've caught them. We've caught them all. We've got it all on tape. We've caught them all. And by the way, you gave the idea for the Logan Act against General Flynn. You better take a look at that because we caught you in a sense. And President Obama was sitting in the office. He knew about it, too. So don't tell me about a free transition.
That's it. That's it. Hey, I'm Jared Jackson. I love America. Today's a good day. It's Constitution Day, people. This live stream will be a no black pill zone today. It's going to be good news, good news, good news in honor of the 234th anniversary of the ratification of the Constitution of the United States. Amen. September 17, 1787 being that day, of course. I am Jaron Jackson, your not quite so humble host. I am a Bible-believing Christian, constitutional defending, patriotic, Rush Baby Linwood, multiple time endorsed and introduced, unvaccinated Trump supporter. I love the ability to walk outside of the house, see the guineas, navigate the minefield of all the poop, get into the Quantum Studios and see you all's lovely digital faces in this little small camera. The Bible is the word of God. The gospel is the power to salvation, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is the only way to go to heaven. Do not be an arrogant moron and go to hell because you will be punished for your sins. Jesus already died on the cross. Believe, turn away from your sin and believe in him, and you will not go to hell because I don't want you to go to hell. Also, one quick admin note. Well, two quick admin notes. First of all, this is the, if you care about the military not having mandatory jabs, there is a lawsuit forthcoming. This is the exact website to go to. There is a GiveSend Go link in the description below that is generated by a member of the audience here, and 100% of the proceeds go there. Now, you might be thinking, Jaron, that doesn't matter. There's no way that they can absolutely win. Well, it's predicated on a very simple premise, the law. Only the president, according to 10 U.S. Code Section 1107, paragraph F.A. or F.1, only the president, there at the bottom, only the president determines in writing that complying with such requirement is not in the interest of national security. Meaning, that means that only the president can override the individual's conscience. So if you are in the military and you don't have informed consent, or you're saying, I want a religious exemption, a medical exemption, I just don't want to take it because I don't know what's in it, the Secretary of Defense, as it's going on right now, has said that you're going to have to take it. Well, it's not the SecDef's authority to do that. It's only the president, and the president, dear leader, godless coming Joe Biden, has not yet ordered it. Moreover, the FDA licensed Comirnaty. Comirnaty is not the drug that is even being manufactured yet until 2023. So please go to the link in the description below. Give money there. 100% of the proceeds goes to that effort. Let's sue the crap out of them and protect our men and women in uniform against this godless commie compelled inoculation. Also, before we get to the update, today is the last day that I will live stream on Facebook and YouTube. I have had a lot of people, hundreds, probably thousands, message me on those platforms and say, would you not go? And I have to go because the godless commies own those platforms. And if I stay there, then I'm complicit and I'm being part of the problem. We have, at this point, this is a civil war. It hasn't gone kinetic yet, but it is absolutely a civil war. And to participate knowingly with those big institutions is part of the problem. It is absolutely part of the problem. Now, if there's people that are like, you know, there's one member of the audience, she says that she stays on Facebook because her son committed suicide in 2016. My heart goes out to her. Amen. Like, stay connected as best as you can. Like, there are individual reasons. I am a content producer and I live stream. There are people, God has blessed me with people who pay attention, and I want to migrate those people to different platforms because I am principally against those platforms. There's not to say that good things can't come from those platforms, but it is high time to separate from them for me. So if you want to stay, that's fine. You will not see me live stream on Facebook or YouTube. We're moving. I am moving. Those links that are in the description, you can find plenty of information there. You can follow me on Telegram. I post all my videos there. I post all the links there. So even if you can't watch me live, there's still live viewing options. There's like four other live viewing options. Plus, I put the videos out other places. Now, last part here. This hurts me because predominantly the most people who watch me are on Facebook and YouTube. So I am looking at my audience. I'm looking at 80% of the views that I get, and I'm saying bye. I'm literally saying goodbye to 80% of my viewers. That is not a smart move if you want to do this as a job. It is a principled move because it's in line with where we're at. And I think there's no better day to announce that and articulate that than on the day that the Constitution was ratified 234 years ago. This is not because I want to do it. It's because I need to do it. And 80% of people, I mean, that's it's going to be bad. It's like I'm looking at 80% of the views that I get within a 24-hour period come from those two platforms, and I'm leaving them because that's the right decision to do, and so I'm going to go. I wish that you would come over. If not, thanks for watching. It's been good. Hopefully, this is a good last show. Roll the rock. Now, with that, I want to say I saw this video right before, right when I was doing show prep, and I just think it's funny, so I'm going to play it.
So I'm just sitting here and I'm thinking, from now on, I refuse to be referred to as unvaccinated. I want everyone to now call me pure blood.
Yeah, one thing I really like about this is it reframes the words. Instead of being called unvaccinated, you call yourself a pureblood. But then I had Steve, who is a member of the audience, message me on Facebook, by the way. Steve, we're not going to be messaging on Facebook anymore. And he said, you know, didn't Hitler use purebloods to make his argument? And he may or may not. I think the idea is to switch the value proposition. Understand that the language, this is a war, in your eyes, in your ears, to dominate the key terrain for the prize of the soul, right? So the words vaccinated and unvaccinated create categories. The in-group is the vaccinated, the people who care for each other, the people who support science and aren't going to die from a virus that doesn't kill 99.997% of people. It's the unvaccinated. Those are the unpatriotic, the hateful, the selfish, the bitter. Those are the people we need to deny resources, British too. Those are the people that we need to hunt and lock in their homes and eliminate their jobs. Like, those are the people that need to off with their heads. Those people, right? So I love the idea of reframing using the value proposition of, instead of valuing being complicit in the Nazi world takeover, the NWO, instead of being complicit in the New World Order type of propaganda, and we're going to get to that too, by the way. Did you know that, well, I'm not going to jump the gun, but Moderna was like, well, I'm jumping the gun. I got them all in sync. Put a pin in that. We will get back to that. But it's understanding the value proposition. It's not a value proposition for me to, you know, retain the blood that God gave me and change it into whatever Dr. Fauci, you know, is genetically editing it to be. But the idea of pure blood versus not pure blood is interesting. Another person said organic. Another person said immunized. I would probably just say I'm as God made me. Something like that. Something along those lines. To that point, I saw on the internet, and I don't know if it's true or not, but I saw this, and again, I can't vouch for this accuracy. I'm just a guy on the internet that posts stuff, but I saw this, and this is presumably unvaccinated blood on the left and vaccinated blood on the right. So I searched at Snopes, and Snopes didn't say that it was false. So that leads me to say that it could potentially be true. I then heard some back and forth from people saying the American Red Cross is not accepting COVID-laden blood. That's not true. You go to their website and they say they absolutely do accept COVID-19 blood. Now, if you are concerned about that, as I might be, there's a way that you can give blood to yourself over the course of time. I forget what it's called, but you can basically say, this is the blood, keep it on file or whatnot, keep it in the cooler. And if you get in a car crash or something, they can put your own blood back into you. So there's ways to get around it for the people who are concerned, as they rightly should be, about getting, you know, transfusions with people who have taken, you know, Nazi-inspired gene editing therapeutics that have, boiled big pharmaceuticals at the behest of the global lockdown and transitioned into a global reset, according to Klaus Schwab. The other thing is, so I want to highlight some good news stories tonight. I want to highlight some good news things. One person invited me if I was ever, I think it was Staten Island. Jaron, if you're ever in Staten Island, come by the America First Warehouse. I did not know about this place, but if you're up there on the East Coast around Staten Island, take a look at this.
Absolutely slaughtered the elderly in the beginning stages of the pandemic. And so far, he's not being held accountable for it. But what we can do, if you want to, we can say, let's see if the legal system will hold him accountable.
And it's just an effort by normal Americans who believe one way very strongly to present their ideas. And the idea here, in celebration of the Constitution, 234 years this day ago, don't ever quit. Do not ever quit. Free speech is baked into the fabric of the American people because it's the robust discussion of ideas that allows us to approximate the truth. Now, that doesn't mean that everyone's ideas, there's truth in them. It means that though we have the freedom to say things, someone might be preaching the Bible out there. Someone might be preaching the gospel. And if you have the freedom to say whatever you want to say, if the people who believe in the Bible, hint, hint, say God's words, they might say them. But this is just a dude that, values America, the Constitution. Trump knows the election was stolen, and he has a big warehouse out in New York City. So go support that. Not too far from Staten Island in Pennsylvania, former state Senator Wagner has been putting up billboards, and the local news networks took notice. This is funny.
Former state Senator Scott Wagner was no stranger to controversy when he was at the state capitol, and that's not changing now that he's back in the private sector. The Republican from York County told ABC 27 he's putting up 15 more billboards across the state showing Joe Biden and the caption, "Making the Taliban Great Again." Wagner is a vocal Trump supporter.
Listen, this is a real big deal that's going down in Afghanistan. I think I've made my point. And I'm you know me. I'm gonna say what's on my mind, and this is what's on my mind, and now it's on a billboard.
Snoop Dogg! I love that. I hope to be memed into a Snoop Dogg video one day. If you understand what's going on, this is a dude. He's got discretionary income, and he's propagating the message. He's putting the message out there. Make the Taliban great again there, Joe Biden. Dear leader, godless commie Joe Biden. Especially on the fact that they nuked kids today. Or a couple weeks back. This is just the promulgation, the propagation, the publication of the fact that Joe Biden is a godless commie. These heathens suck at governing. They're trying to destroy the country. You cannot be this horrible. You cannot. I mean, think about you're either supremely incompetent for having been in government for 50 years. Because in 7 months, you've basically run the country through the crapper. And you have us where we are today. I'm going to get into the military here in phase one when it talks about nuking kids. And it's like, how are you that stupid? How is your military that bad? I think it's on purpose. I think they're culling the herd. I got a message from one of my platoon sergeants when I was lieutenant today. And he was like, I got 7 more months to retirement. What you got? And I was like, man, I'm working on this lawsuit. I'm trying to do stuff. And he's like, he's at a training center right now, and they're making them wear wristbands. If members of the military aren't vaccinated, the military is making those people identify themselves by wearing wristbands. Now, one of the ideas in the military is teamwork. How can you be a team if while you're on the same team, you bifurcate, you identify the people who are less than, other than, not us? If you somehow diminish other people based on their own decisions, that doesn't necessarily impact unit cohesion, unit performance, or national security. These are the implications that I don't think a lot of people think through, and they might not be able to articulate. But man, this guy, the commies, it runs deep. So another person I want to celebrate, and for this we go down under. Now, for the past couple of weeks, I have been reporting that, I think I'm getting better at that accent, down under, basically Nazi Germany. Well, I want to direct someone to a hero. Those Aussies, you guys probably know this guy. I hope I'm not wrong. I don't think I am. His name is Clive Palmer. He's into mining. He's a multi-billionaire. And this is his Twitter profile. So this is him, and he's basically, make Australia great. Put Australia first. Amen, put Australia first if you're in Australia. But if you're competing against the U.S., we're going to trounce you because we're America. But yeah, put Australia first. And look at this guy. This guy's got a sense of humor. He's got a lot of money. And he said this at a recent press conference.
To me personally is the fact that both Pfizer and AstraZeneca would not allow their products to be sold in Australia unless the Australian government gave them a full indemnity. If they killed anyone or maimed them, they wouldn't be responsible, the government would be. So I find that a very disturbing thing, that the government didn't take the view and say, well, if you're confident in your product, you should stand behind it.
Yeah, so he's saying if you're so far behind if you back your product, why do you have to have the, what's it called? Why do you have to have the protections? Why do you have to have the government protections if you're not going to hurt anybody, if you're not going to kill anybody? This strikes at the very heart of medical tyranny. If these tyrants weren't defended by the government, if they weren't protected from culpability from their defective, I shouldn't say defective, if they weren't protected from culpability from their engineered bioweapons, we're really trying to get kicked off tonight, folks. We're trying to justify the fact that we're leaving Facebook and YouTube. This guy has the guts to say what's true. And this is powerful because he's not the only person. There's other people. This is the construction workers in Sydney who aren't vaccinated. So these are the pure bloods. These are the organics. These are the image bearers of God, as God made them, I should say. And so these people, these construction workers, aren't allowed to eat in these restaurants. So every day they go outside in the middle of the street, they set up tables, they set up chairs, and they eat. Look at the numbers of them. Look at what themes they have in common. We'll discuss after. Watch this. They're all men. Now, if those men aren't taking the jab, they're going to lose their job. You're going to have a couple effects. And this is what's called an economics, an externality. An externality is something that you can't quite account for, but as a result of a decision, usually a government heavy-handed policy, there's a byproduct that they couldn't have anticipated. And here's one of the things that these godless commies can't anticipate, won't anticipate, didn't anticipate. In fact, I don't have it. Remember that that thing when Jen Psaki circled back and said, we didn't anticipate that. We didn't anticipate that. We didn't anticipate that. Those are externalities. In economics, this is an externality. The externality here is the very real observation is that all of those dudes won't have a job. So if all of those construction workers aren't doing work at construction, then construction isn't getting worked on. So who would be hurting from the people who won't be doing the work on construction jobs? The people trying to do construction jobs. And what types of people are the types of people that have workers that do construction for them? the really rich people, the guys building buildings or homes or anything else. And so the people who are trying to facilitate and lobby the compelled coercion and penetration, that's what I'm going to start calling this. I'm going to start calling this the penetration agenda. This is the penetration agenda. And why do I do that, Jaron? That sounds kind of icky. It's supposed to. It's supposed to rile you up. It's like the word moist. No one likes the word moist. Saying the word moist is like, ugh, it's disgusting. Stop saying moist. Moist, moist, moist. These people are trying to penetrate people that they don't know. They're trying to penetrate them with something that's dangerous. They're trying to penetrate people against their wills. Now, why would they want to penetrate other people? Because these people want to penetrate everything. There's a scene in Team America that I really want to reference right now, but I can't. Kid show, right? Kid friendly, I should say. These workers aren't going to work. It's going to hurt the people who are building things. The people who are hurt building things now, not only top of that, but now the government has a bunch of unemployed, strong, masculine, calloused-handed dudes. What do you think is going to happen to a bunch of those strong, working, type, callous-handed people? Man, they're prime people, prime positioned to respond in very specific ways to this government dictate. Interesting. I want to say thank you to Teddy Daniels, who gave a shout out to the workers in Australia. Teddy Daniels, of course, is a good friend of mine. Truth right here. God bless. Shout out to all the dads that be eating like this so their kids could eat at the table at home. That is just all over the place. If you're a worker, if you're a manual laborer, you are the backbone of the country. You make the country work because you do work. And I just want to say thank you not only to Teddy for spotting it out. He's Pennsylvania 8. Go ahead and support him. But also just the dudes that will never be highlighted, the dudes that will never be celebrated, the blue-collar folks, the ones with the dirt in the cuticles and the calluses on the hands. Amen, folks. Don't give up. You are the ones that make things go. The other thing is I just feel out of touch. I feel out of touch. Because I hear conservatives. Now, I'm not picking on this guy. I generally agree with what he says. I generally agree with his position. Michael Knowles, he's a Christian, works at Daily Wire. He's a espoused Christian, works at Daily Wire. I just don't get it that you can be paying attention to people that say stuff like this. The vaccines are so effective that you need a booster and so safe that the FDA won't approve the booster. Do I have that right? Yeah. Because it's hypocritical, because these people aren't about science, they're not about medicine, they're about control. And in their pursuit of control, almost like they were accelerated, they're fumbling over themselves and they're not making sense of the rules that we've all lived by. They're not making sense of the rules that we all play by, the rules that we all agree to, and they're not making sense. And so you have conservatives. You have pundits that are out there that are pro-jab, that are anti-vaxxer, and they're sitting here saying, I don't agree with these guys not to take the vaccine, but it's the right not to take it. Well, yeah, but you're a conservative pundit. You should be looking at the authority of the government to mandate this stuff, right? Why are you looking at me and my personal medical decisions when you should be looking at the government on this 234th anniversary of our Constitution and not accept the flawed premise? The flawed premise is that the government doesn't have the ability to create the FDA. The government doesn't have the authority to make the CDC. The government sure as hell does not have the ability to compel you to take something you don't want to take. Like, we got to get at first roots here, first principles. The Latin here is principium. Say this with me. Principium. Sound smart. Next time you go talk to someone, say the principium. Principium, first principles. The first principle is limited government. That is the subtext of the American system, is that government should be limited. Go read Federalist 51. Men are not angels and so therefore must be governed. But because government is made of man, government therefore must be limited. The founders were smart because they believed the Bible. The founders were smart because they had clear thinking. The founders were brilliant because they could articulate said things. It's when we get away from our moorings, it's when we become unattached to our foundation, or when we substitute our foundation for something more sandy. No offense to you guys named Sandy, but whenever you have a foundation worth of sand, as soon as the storm comes, Jesus was talking about that in Matthew 7. Another thing I want to point out is, so you've got all these Afghans coming in, right? You've got all these, Haitians. Haitians, Afghans. This is Del Rio Crossing in Texas. Watch this. you heard the helicopter pilot start to say, this is insane. Specifically what happened, there's about 700 to 1,000 Haitians down at the Del Rio crossing. There's multiple crossings like this in Texas. Joe Biden last week said that they're not going to deport any more Haitians. So what the Haitians do, they picked up their Obama phones and they said, hey, you come here to America. It's like they're bringing their voodoo and all their drugs up with them through the southern border. And as they cross over, what's going to happen? I don't know. But there's people at the border, politicians, speaking out about this mass border crisis. Ted Cruz is one of them. Watch this.
I'm here in Del Rio, Texas, September 16th. I'm underneath the bridge. Behind me are 10,503 people. This is a crisis that is unfolding. It's a man-made crisis.
I like Ted Cruz. I voted for him. I donated for him on December 31st, 2015. I gave him $1,000 when he's running for president. I was a Cruz guy before I was a Trump guy, just FYI. But why isn't this guy talking about the audits? You're talking about the border. You can see that. You can see massive amounts of people. Now, don't mistake me. I want to shut down all immigration. All. I don't want anybody coming to America. Whenever you shut down businesses and you destroy small and medium-sized businesses, I don't want people who aren't Americans to come to America. Why? Because our government inflicted pain on the American people, and the solution is not to bring people who aren't America to come in to work for America for the businesses that didn't get shut down. Hello, Walmart. Hello, Costco. Hello, Amazon and Google and all these other monopolies. You're not going to supplant citizens as your labor for illegal immigrants as a, you know, as a, well, we're just not going to deport people today. You can't do that. You're not supposed to be able to do that, and yet they do. We'll get to that here in a second when we talk about the Constitution. But what's going on is that Trump is the president. They stole the 2020 election. And Ted Cruz, one of the most famous senators there in the state of Texas and the country, isn't talking about the audits. Why? Why are you not talking about the audits, Ted? You're going to go to the border in hopes to elevate the profile and highlight the issue for your potential 2024 campaign. Trump's going to come down the escalator again, and you're going to back out. Everybody else will, because we all know Trump's the president. He's going to trounce anybody who runs on the Republican side. But why are you going to go to the border? What's the effect of this? The effect of this is people like me, people like you, see that, and we get mad. We get pissed, royally pissed. We get angry. What are we going to do with that, Ted? You're in the minority because the Democrats stole two senator seats on January 5th because the elections, the special election on January 5th was rigged in Georgia because it was rigged on November 3rd in Georgia. So they stole Georgia for president from President Trump and gave it to Biden. And then they stole two U.S. Senate seats from, admitted, you know, they weren't like the best of Republicans, but at least they were not godless commie Democrats. They were godless commie Republicans, which at least have a fig leaf of a hint of love for America. But you stole the election on November 3rd in Georgia. You stole the election on January 5th in Georgia. So now you've got the Democrats with the tie-breaking vote of Kabbalah, let me sleep to the way of the top, Harris. So she's able to break the tie. And so you, as Ted Cruz, the senator from Texas, are doing what? You're going to stand on the border and say, this stuff is all bad. This is bad. See, all this stuff is bad. And Americans, rightly so, because we've been conditioned by controlled opposition to think, yeah, the Democrats are really bad. But meanwhile, we never look at the Republicans. When's Ted made a statement about the audits? Ted, audit the 2020 election. Audit it. Why? Why no audits? Why no audits? And this is why I feel, as a conservative without a home, as a patriot without a party. Why? Because the people who are supposed to be standing for us, espousing our values, are doing what? Well, did you know that the border is being overrun by all these Haitians? Yeah, no, I got that, because a godless commie that's pulling the levers of power right now, that's just dictating the way and shredding the Constitution, he's not supposed to be there. He stole the freaking election. That's why, like, the border crisis is because there's an election crisis, because there's a vote crisis. That's why. Are we going to address the symptoms, or are we going to take care of the issue? We're going to take care of the source. It's just bonkers. It's bonkers to me, because these people are controlled opposition. How do I know that? Who did Ted Cruz's wife work for? Anyway, they're going to bring in more Afghans. This is from Breitbart today. Hey, we botched Afghanistan. We nuked kids. We killed American military, and we brought tens of thousands of unvetted, undocumented, illegal immigrants from Afghanistan here to America. We paid for their flights on our military planes. We left the equipment. We left the weapons. Hell, we even left American citizens, but we brought them. And you know what? Chamber of Commerce, we're going to give them jobs. We're going to say, you know what? We got all these Afghans here. Let's put them to work because of free market capitalism. This is the stupidity of conservatives. This is the stupidity of the people. I said I wasn't going to get mad at it. This is the stupidity of where we are. All you got to say is free market capitalism. This isn't free market capitalism. It's not a free market when you import people who don't deserve to be here, didn't wait in line, didn't obey the law. They are the unfortunate victims of our own military adventurism. And so the military creates a crisis, destabilizes a country, pulls out of Afghanistan, completely dismisses all strategy, FM30 Chapter 5, by the way, completely dismisses how to do a retrograde, basic Ranger school stuff. And then they bring people who aren't American over here, and they're like, well, you know, they're here. We might as well try to give them jobs. No, don't give them jobs. And if you read the article, what do they want to do? Watch out, let me jihad this. No pun intended. Actually, yeah, pun intended. What do they want to do? Where do they want to put them? Where is this the thing? Nah, da, 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 da. Commerce Foundation, blah, blah, blah. They wanted to... Look at that. The Chamber is teaming up with Welcome.us. Welcome.us, a newly created non-governmental organization backed by presidents Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, Barack Obama, former First Ladies Hillary Clinton, Laura Bush, Michelle Obama, quote, to mobilize the American people around welcoming Afghan refugees. On behalf of Americans who value the Constitution, our culture, the rule of law, and the fact that we see through this godless commie scheme, get back on the jet and go back home and take Obama and Clinton and the Bushes with you. See how long their welcoming attitude will survive in other areas of the world. Other areas of the world that don't value truth, that don't value the rule of law, and this document says we can't kill these guys? Yeah, so we're not going to kill them. These people have contributed way more to the destabilization of the entire world and the rifting of the United States than anybody else. And they do it under the banner of Welcome.us. That is certainly a lie fit for Satan. I got like a couple more articles. Should I go? Should I just do it more? Yeah, let's just do it. You know what else these people are doing? You know what else these people are doing? They withdrew the Patriot batteries in Saudi Arabia. Patriot batteries, of course, are the ICBM interceptors, intercontinental ballistic missile interceptors. So if someone shoots a big nuke, the Patriot batteries shoot down that nuke. The U.S. is pulling them out. So we pulled out of Afghanistan, bungled that. We're pulling our Patriot batteries out of Saudi Arabia, which basically says if someone tries to nuke or missile Saudi Arabia, the American Patriot batteries are there under the pretext of we're going to shoot them down for you. So whenever you pull out the things that are supposed to shoot down incoming rockets, what you're really telling Saudi Arabia is we don't care if there's incoming rockets because we're leaving. Now, George Washington said, don't get caught up in foreign entanglements. Amen. So part of me really likes this. Saudi Arabia should be able to do their own stuff. Well, at the same time, you look at what we're doing overseas. You look at all the stuff that we're messing up, and it's like, this is a planned destruction of America's international power. This is a planned destruction and a, you know, just purposefully diving this plane into the ground, destroying where we're at. Now, another example. Enchanté, bon chéri, a drink of the wine and smell of the cheese. France. France is withdrawing their ambassadors. France, permanent member of the UN Security Council. Not that I care about the UN Security Council, but this is enchanté français. France is withdrawing their ambassadors from the US, from Australia, because Australia is going to buy nukes or buy nuclear submarines from the United States. I wonder where France is going to go. My money tells me Russia. What you want to bet? What you want to bet within a week or two, we start to see the foreign ministers and the military people of Enchanté, Bonchanté, France go to Moscow, or Moscow come to Paris, the city of lights. What's the point in all this? The point in all this is that there's an international deconstruction and repositioning of things because the godless commie in the White House basically is degaffing. Not the fact that he doesn't care, but that he's doing it on purpose. From the border crisis to, I mean, you know, we butcher more babies in the womb now. The number of abortions are actually going up. They're actually going up. We're like to 1,700 a day, up to like, up from last year was like 1,300 babies being slaughtered every day in the womb. It's just crazy. All right, last thing I want to point out here, and this may be vicious. I don't know if I should do this. I don't know if I should. You know what? I'm going to do it. Screw it. I'm already there. This article from the Daily Mail the other day. Fully vaccinated woman's family blames unvaccinated Americans for her death in scathing obituary. Quote, she was infected by others who chose not to be. The cost was her life. Couple different things I want to go to this because I think that no one will touch this in the way that I will. So let's just put the finger in the eye and go straight for the jugular. I am a Christian. I want all people to come to Christ so that no one goes to hell. This thinking, this reason, this mind is not sound thinking. This is an antichrist demonic doctrine because it presupposes that death is authoritated or death's authority is the FDA, is Fauci, is a vaccine. Do not let me miss you. Do not let that miss you. These people are assuming that you cannot die if you obey what they say. The thinking is that if you take the vaccine, you will somehow not die. They don't understand the irony. This is how depraved their thinking is. They don't understand the irony of a woman who is fully vaccinated got sick by people who weren't vaccinated. Doesn't that say the vaccine doesn't work? But then the second thing is, how do you know? How do you know who made her sick? Is there an investigation? Can you prove? Show me the evidence of the virus's pathogen. Show me the evidence of where the virus entered her nose or entered her mouth or where did it come from? And how do you know that person wasn't unvaccinated? Do you battle track, as we would say in the Army? Do you battle track that viral particle and then know that, okay, the viral particle went into her nose and it's been embedded there. And because we know that the virus can be there for like 2-3 weeks, It was embedded there for 2 weeks and all of a sudden it went and then went down into a respiratory system and then it died. So they're not thinking about the efficacy of the virus. That is before their assumptions, right? They're never even going to question the virus. Why? Because this is what they worship, folks. This is an idolatrous perspective and it needs to be gutted because these people are only going to continue to advance these ways of thinking. Let's get to the actual obituary and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. People are going to be like, oh, you're so hateful. No, I'm not hateful. To be hateful is to accept these lies. Now, this woman, Candace K. Ayers, is the woman who died. I pray for her family. I hope she knew Jesus. I really want to see this woman in heaven. I don't want her to be in hell. That is my honest perspective. That is my honest testimony. I do not want this woman in hell. And if she repented of her sins and believed in the gospel, regardless of what her politics was, she's in heaven. You need to hear that again. If she repented of her sin and trusted in the resurrected Christ, that woman is in heaven. How do I know that? 2 Corinthians 5 verse 8, to be absent the body is to be present with the Lord. The justification is immediate. As soon as you believe the gospel, you are there. Go read John 5. All you have to do is repent and believe. That's Jesus talking, by the way. But let's look at her obituary. Springfield, Illinois, Candace K. Krueger Ayers, 66, of Springfield, passed away on September 3rd, 2020 at St. John's Hospital in Springfield, Illinois. She was preceded in death by more than 4,531,799 others infected with COVID-19. She was vaccinated but was infected by others who chose not to be. The cost was her life. Now, this is the lie, and it shows the evil nature of the people's hearts who wrote that. That's her children. So probably millennial children who hate Jesus, who they are going to go to hell unless they repent of their sin and believe the gospel. But you understand the hate that's here. By saying that she was preceded in death by 4,531,799, what are they doing? They're linking her death with all the other people who died. Where again, we're not going to ask the question, where'd all the flu deaths go? We're not going to look at the fact that the CDC themselves revised their own statistics from 2020 into 21, that 94% of the deaths that they attributed to COVID were not attributed to COVID. Are we not going to look at the fact that most people who die from COVID actually die from COVID, have 2, 3, 4 comorbidities? Yeah, that guy was grossly fat and overweight. That dude had heart problems. He was missing most of his lungs. It's like there's comorbidities that make people more susceptible to death. Because of sin, our bodies diminish. They die. We're not going to live forever unless you believe the gospel. Amen. But they don't think like that. They probably think that they come from monkeys. At which point, what moral authority, what moral basis do they have to complain that something that was natural, right? Is this a bioweapon, folks? Is this virus that's killing all these people? Is this natural? Is this just evolution? Was it evolution that these scientists took American money without permission and secretly funded it into UNC Chapel Hill and the Wuhan lab to design a virus that was more transmissible, gain of function research? Is just this natural evolution? Is it natural evolution for evil people to do evil things? See, there's so many conflating thoughts here. They're not consistent. And here's the most important one. This is the one that really caught my attention. At the very end, whenever her family says, she is survived by her loving husband of nearly 43 years, Terry of Springfield, her children, Mark, Samantha Ayers of Springfield, Amanda Foster, and her triplet 5-year-old children, Andy, Daniel, and Charlotte Foster of Springfield, who were the loved ones of her life. Now, here I want to say it is a tragedy. Again, it's a tragedy that she died. All death is a tragedy. And again, I want her to have known Jesus, because if she knows Jesus, she ain't worried about anything because she's with Christ. But understand, she said, the family said that she was preceded in death by the 4,531,799 people who also died from COVID. But she survived by only her family member. If they're going to be intellectually consistent, wouldn't she be survived by the 7 billion plus people who aren't dead and haven't died from COVID? See, the inconsistencies in these people thinking, because if they don't have Christ as their focus, then they arbitrarily get to prioritize and shift things around. They get to gaslight. They get to lie. They get to have equivocation in their thinking. It's a tragedy she died. It actually is. I'll even grant the premise that she died from COVID. But you miss out comorbidities, you miss out flu, you miss out the fact that it's a bioengineered weapon, you miss the fact that you're misattributing her death to someone else. I mean, who's culpable? Who's culpable? Show me the person who had the viral particulate go in the air, put itself in her nose or in her respiratory system, growing from there, go. And then do the doctors have culpability? Did the doctors advance the CDC protocol? Or did they use ivermectin? Did they use hydroxychloroquine? Science. Oh boy, that was important. I want to do this article. This is Joe Biden. I don't have the main article. Joe Biden is now, it's public news, national news. Joe Biden nuked kids. He accidentally had a drone strike that went against and killed 10 civilians. This is Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin apologizes. If we actually look at the words of his apology, oh, that's the wrong thing. Let me do this. Where are you at? Come on. I can't click on the thing. All right. Let me try this. Let me do this, this. I have so many things brought up. There we go. All right, here we go. This is the thing. It said the investigation concluded that the strike. So they've investigated the strike. They haven't investigated why they screwed the pooch on the exfil. Conducted to prevent what was believed to be an imminent threat to Hamid Karzai International Airport. Now let me, I'm sorry, I have to do this. They had intel that the Karzai Airport was going to be attacked. Again, think before this. What's the context here? The context here is that they thought they were going to be attacked. 13 soldiers had died. So they have intel assets. Where were the intel assets that were painting the picture of the Taliban taking over provincial capitals in a rapid pace? Was there no intel there? They have intel that they're going to be attacked at the Hamid Karzai Airport, but they don't have intelligence from around the country that massive amounts of Taliban are congregating, consolidating, and otherwise conquering provincial capitals? Also, why are they at the Hamid Karzai Airport and not at Bagram? Bagram's a military post. Why did they do Karzai Airport? This just tells you that this was not a military operation, or if it was bungled from the get-go. It's just stupid how these people are so moronic and evil. I'm not going to say they're stupid. I'm going to think they're evil. I think they did this on purpose. But look at that. Down at the bottom. We apologize and we will endeavor to learn from this horrible mistake. You know what this really is saying? We killed you. You can't do anything about it. But we know that people are their heartstrings are going to be pulled when they hear that kids are dead. So we're sorry. And I could just imagine the boss. What's his name? Lumberg. Lumberg. I could just imagine Lumberg on the office space going, yeah, if you could get that apology out, that would be great. Kids died, so they're going to be pretty upset. Yeah. And that's, they don't care. Do you think that they care? Do you think that they care about these nameless, faceless children? They don't see people as image bearers of God. They see them as CivCas, civilian casualties. And if you think about it, if you're going to launch a drone strike, in my experience, there is positive identification, which means that someone, before that missile was dropped, before that drone initiated the attack, someone had eyes on and cleared it. Who's that person? Who is the person that declared positive identification? What was their authority? Did they actually have permissive ROE? I mean, if you think that there's a humanitarian crisis and there's Americans that are going to be evacuated from a civilian airport, not a military airport, then why would you not have restrictive ROE, rules of engagement, that said that you can't just drop nukes from the sky? It's not a nuke. It's a Predator drone. I get it's a Hellfire missile, not a nuke. I just like saying nukes instead of a Hellfire. So we'll say Hellfire for those of you purists out there. If you're going to drop a Hellfire out in that engagement area, out in that area, and you've got intelligence of an imminent attack, wouldn't you have positive identification? And if you're dropping a Hellfire, why didn't you engage it with a different weapon system? Why not a direct weapon system like a rifle or a machine gun, something that's actually controlled and has better battlefield effects, and you can better control a direct weapon system, a direct weapon fire system, than you can a Hellfire missile? And here's the last thing. What pilot can't discriminate between children and adults? Kids don't run like people. Kids don't run like adults. They don't look like adults. This has FUBAR all over it. This is one big massive cluster, and it's because I think they did it on purpose. Constitution, right? Let's talk about the Constitution. I wanted to have a good time. Hey, the founders, 234 years ago, on September 17, 1787, ratified our Constitution, and it is the longest, best constitutional document in the world. Now, I said, and I've titled this, The Constitution's Best Secret. A lot of people today will talk to you about all sorts of different stories, about the story of the woman coming up to Benjamin Franklin, and she says, hey, good doctor, have you given us a monarchy or a republic? I would imagine she's some type of Irish person in my mind. Have you given us a monarchy or a republic? And Benjamin Franklin says, a republic, if you can keep it. And then, of course, the talking point is always, we have to be vigilant. And then you've got the other quote that says that from Hamilton that says the Constitution was written for a whole moral and religious people. It is completely inadequate if that ever changes. Basically, if people lose their Christianity, the Constitution is not for that people. It's going to be incompatible with whatever culture is not Christian. That's the subtext there. If you disagree, go back and study Hamilton. The dude loved Jesus, wrote and got a lot of his ideas from John Locke's Second Treatise of Government. And that book, John Locke's Second Treatise of Government, quoted the Bible over 1,500 times. So for the people who are like, we're a secular government, first of all, the preamble says blessings of liberty. What is blessings of liberty in a secular perspective? Your mindset sucks. But if you think about it from the founder's perspective, the context in which they had, the culture that gave us the Constitution, there's actually something that's really awesome that I don't know if you have taken the time to think about. Of course, you know this. Yeah, nothing I'm going to say is something you've never heard. But consider what the Constitution is, the product of where it came from, and what that means for us today. Simply put, the Constitution is the result of learning from our mistakes. The Articles of Confederation were the founders' first attempt to have a cobbled together government after the Revolutionary War. And if you think about that, they were so afraid of a central government that they first gave us the Articles of Confederation. And the Articles of Confederation, ironically named AOC, not AOC today isn't the first thing that's failed to have that moniker in American politics, but the first AOC that failed was because there wasn't enough power given to the central government. Because they were approaching the thing that had to be done with an aversion to doing that thing. Do not let me lose you. The founders were looking at government. They were so scared of a tyrant like King George III becoming here in America, almost like dear godless commie Joe Biden, right? They were so want to not have King George III, to have that centralized power, that authority, that centralized authority to tell them what to do, that they evaded. They didn't want to touch it. They tried to withdraw from the central notion of government, which is authority. Government exists to compel behavior. That's what government does. The debate is therefore what is right, what is moral, what is just, what is necessary. That's the big debate. But government does one thing and one thing really well. It compels behavior. Now, the founders wanted to not go there because they wanted to kind of bank on the culture. They wanted to look at where people were and say, well, we got a good thing going on here. We can kind of keep these things going. Like someone with a bunch of basketballs on them, right? Like spinning this one and spinning this one, and they're all going to go, right? Well, it ended up not failing for all sorts of reasons, but I wanted to focus on the Constitution and why it's awesome. The best secret of the Constitution is the founders failed before the Constitution. The Constitution is the residue of them failing and learning from their failures. And this, my friends, is the greatest part of the United States of America. It is not our Constitution. It is that we had a culture that was able to learn from our mistakes, admit our mistakes, learn from them, and then keep pushing and never quitting. Now, if you can apply that to today, think about where we are. We have a system. Our system is good. Our system has been exploited. It's been corrupted by a bunch of godless commies. It's been corrupted by a bunch of professional politicians that would rather line their pockets than uphold their oath. But that doesn't mean that our Constitution is bad. That doesn't mean that our federal system is wrong. It means that the people that we have allowed to take those levers of power are wrong. Now, if we can accept that, that's premise one in my part, is that we got a bunch of godless commies in positions of power. Because they lust after power, and generally speaking, most Americans are just like, let me live my life. I want to be left alone. And that's a good thing. And let me tell you why. I did an interview today. I did a podcast today, and I said something that I wish I could have said better. So I'll say it better here. When we make mistakes, we need to understand the essence of our mistake. The founders in the Articles of Confederation, their number one mistake was looking at the central power that they saw in King George III, and they said that we don't want that at all, let's get away from it. So their aversion to centralizing power was the seed of destruction for the Articles of Confederation. Make sense? The seeds for the Constitution, or the Constitution therefore, grew out of that failure, recognizing that failure. Likewise, I think we need to recognize that the seed of our present danger, the seed of our current godlessness, is comfort. It's convenience. It's complacency. It is the fact that men don't have calluses on their hands. It's the fact that we think mom and dad have to work in order to provide a living. It's the fact that divorce is just, oh yeah, I don't like you anymore, let's get wrong. Now, if I'm stepping on your toes, chill. The Bible teaches that what God makes whole, let man not separate. I understand that there's divorce. I understand there's all sorts of stuff. But whenever you break the family, don't you think that there's not going to be ramifications to that? Don't you know that the four spheres of government that God has established, government, like the actual government, is the last one? The first one is conscience. The moral law is written on your heart, Book of Romans. The second one is the family. Mom, dad. You can't have a kid without a mom and a dad. The mom and the dad are showing that child how they should raise. Proverbs and Psalm is all about teach a kid the way that they should live, and whenever they get old, they will not depart from it. The third sphere of authority is the church. Right? Jesus says, you better square with your brother until he takes you to the magistrate, because if he takes you to the magistrate, you're going to be put in prison for every single thing that you own. The subtext there is have relationships with people that are not legal, that are not in the context of government. You are Social Security number 12345678. You are a vaccinated person. You are an unvaccinated person. Why do we think about people in the context of political categories? That's stupid. Not only do you strip them of their individuality, not only do you flip God off and say, hey, this image bearer that you made right here on purpose with the purpose, I'm just going to say black. There you go. There's your black label. You are black. You are not black. You are white. You're a homophobe. Why do we do that? Don't do that. And then the last sphere of authority is government. One thing I want to say about this, I got two more things. A lot of Christians like to say, well, Romans 13 says that we need to submit to the government. 1 Peter chapter 2 says we need to honor the government. We need to submit to our authorities. Understand the context that those things were written. And to this, I'll give a hat tip to a guy named Douglas Wilson. You should look him up. He's pretty smart. He has a thought that I was also thinking, so it's not entirely him. But it's this idea that when the Bible was written, the Bible was written to those people at that time. When I read the Bible, I shouldn't think of Jaron 21st century as I read. I need to go back in a time machine to what that message would have been like, what it would have been received as to the people who first received it. Romans chapter 13 that says submit to your government, but then also says the government doesn't wield the sword in vain. It's about those Christians that are in a pagan nation that have never had the authority of Christianity or the influence of Christianity. Fast forward 300 years, Christians became so prevalent that they got rid of the Colosseum. There were no more killings. They were killing Christians en masse, but a couple hundred years later, because of Christians being faithful to the Word of God, by preaching the Bible, by preaching the gospel, and by loving their neighbors, guess what? They changed the entire empire with no army. No army. The Christians changed everything. So much so that whenever Constantine won his battle, what was Constantine's major influence? A church father named Lactantius, who grew up a non-believer, converted to Christianity, and recognized, holy crap, the government can't tell the church what to do. And so the very seeds of Western civilization, the separation of church and state, not the superiority of church or of state over the church, but that they're different spheres of authority. And the different spheres of authority comes from Christian thinking. You're welcome. What can I say except you're welcome? Magna Carta, 1215. 1209, King John takes over for his deceased brother, Richard the Lionheart. Richard the Lionheart dies, was a great king. King John sucked. King John was looking for money. King John saw that the Catholic Church, which was in place, had a bishop that died. Well, the king's role was to put the bishop in place. So the king, instead of electing a bishop, just said, you know what? I will take the money because the bishops collected the tithes. So King John said, I'm going to collect the tithe. Well, that didn't happen. So what was the recourse there? The first live local. The first live local, the first sheriffs. Sheriffs began as feudal lords around feudal England. And so what do? They corralled, they rallied themselves up. They lived local. They got teams together with the people that they knew. Hint, 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 hint. They trained with their neighbors. They got themselves together, and then they waged a war, and they sieged London. And they forced King John I to sign the Magna Carta, which enshrined the limitations of the state. You have Christians influencing the limited government principle throughout the last 1,000-plus years of history. Know your history. Let's fast forward to America. When King George III actually put the crown on and became the dude that was in charge in 1762, 1763, you've got the Stamp Acts. Well, what's he doing the Stamp Acts for? Because he's wanting to wage war and pay for his war against France, enchanté. So what's he do? He's like, let's go tax these Americans. The Americans, get this, the founders didn't push back on the fact that they were being taxed. The founders pushed back on the fact that they weren't being represented. See, they didn't argue against the taxes. They argued against the prima facie observation that they had no representation. They had no recourse. That's why the First Amendment gives you the ability to address or petition your government for redress of grievance. They did it because the government was treating them bad. It wasn't recognizing their God-given rights, their God-given freedom. Now, when people say, well, I'm free and I can do whatever I want, understand Galatians 5, the purpose of liberty is to pursue virtue. Just because you can do something doesn't mean you should do something. This is where you got to integrate your entire worldview. And if you haven't done that, you're doing America a disservice. When King George III started putting his thumb on the American people, it was around 1762. Well, we didn't declare independence until 1776. So if y'all guys are over here, we need to rise up. The founders had 14 years, this Declaration of Independence says, after a long train of abuses and usurpations. After a long train of abuses and usurpations. They were a Christian people. They were a Christian culture. They wanted peace. They didn't want warfare. And because they wanted peace and they didn't want warfare, they were patient. And it wasn't until the British, and it wasn't until the Redcoats started to compel them. And guess what? In their impatience, the American people started to knit together form militias at the local level. Hint, hint, hint. They started to work together with their local people. And then whenever the British decided to, you know, they snapped their fingers and they started to engage militarily, what'd they do? They bit off more than they could chew, homie. And the very small fraction of the American patriots, because they were the minority, the very small minority of American patriots were able to overwhelm them because they were resourceful, they were ingenious, they fought, they were faster, they were more able to swim amongst the sea of people because they didn't stand out in stark red coats. Likewise, today, there's many corrupt fake politicians who won't speak truth. That's why it's important to speak truth. If you use, bad words, and not bad words like curse words, but if you use words that have double standard like universal healthcare or climate change or there's a crisis at the border, you're not saying true things. You're saying things that people can observe to be true, but you're not speaking to the heart of the matter. The heart of the matter is that because America has been complacent, America has gotten so comfortable without God that now we're over here going, what the crap is going on? Who do we turn to? And if you don't have people preaching a hot gospel, pushing them back to the Bible, and advocating that they live local and go to their local churches, it's failure. Failure. Let's say Trump comes back today. Have we learned our lesson? Have we learned the lesson to undo at the local level to become communities that are resilient, neighbors that are aligned with locked shields? Have we done that yet? And if we haven't done that yet, have we really learned from our mistakes? So like the founders who gave us the Constitution in September of 1787, they learned from their failures of 1783. And from 1783, they're like, man, we kind of screwed this pooch, y'all. We got to learn from our mistakes because we made mistakes. So the first step is admitting you made a mistake. The second is being like, okay, we got to figure this crap out. We got to figure out what's the common denominator. And I submit to you, my brothers and sisters, tonight, the common denominator is Jesus Christ. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the unifying thing, or it's the dividing thing. It's the ultimate divider or uniter. If someone disagrees with me politically, but they believe in the resurrected Christ, I can and will unite with them because we are one church. We need to have grace towards these people that are unvaxxed, vaxxed, Democrat, Republican, Bernie people. I don't see how you could do that, but sure, whatever. If someone claims that they've repented of their sin and they put their trust for their atonement, the atonement of their sin in Jesus Christ, they are going to go to heaven. That's what the Bible teaches. You can look at the Hebrews 11 when it talks about Solomon. He got in just barely. Why? Because he believed in God, though he was a really horrible person. Really did a lot of bad stuff, but he had faith in God. Point is that Jesus Christ died for our sins. Everybody's sins. All past, all present, all future. He rose from the grave 3 days later. You believe in that, you will go to heaven. You do not believe that, you will go to hell. As far as America is concerned, America exists because we had Christian men who read their Bibles, had a relationship with Jesus Christ, and were able to admit their mistakes. From admitting their mistakes, they turned away from them, repenting. They repented of their political miscalculations, and they entertained new ideas. Where do they get them? The Bible. Where does live local come? 1 Thessalonians 4. You get ideas from the Bible. Turn to God and listen to Him. On the way forward, if we're still looking at the national headlines, if we're still praying for Trump's return in exchange or in lieu of us actually doing the work, then we haven't learned our lesson. If we're wanting celebrities who are in a box to be like, Jaron, what was the link for the American frontline doctors? we need to be able to produce and provide for ourselves or for the people that are in our local areas. There's a lot of people who are hurting. There's a lot of need for compassion and prayer. Absolutely. This is also the time for the church to step up. Not only to step up in its preaching of the gospel, which is what it should be doing anyway, but in its time to step up to love other people. If you are not in a body of local believers and you're about to get fired from your job, who's going to help you? Are you going to be dependent on the government? Because that's just perpetuating the cycle of enslavement to man-made systems. That's idolatry. If your only recourse of salvation or provision is the government, I'd ask you to relook your base assumptions. In Acts chapter 2, there's a picture of the early church, and these people are poor, destitute, they're hunted politically. These are the people that are dipped in oil and set afire as garden lights for Nero's garden parties. It's a bad time. But because they were in such communion and they were local, they lived local. Because of that, they knew each other. They knew the problems. Here's some tomatoes. I've got a big stack of gold because I'm doing really well. People need to get away from the materialism. They need to get away from the comfort. They need to get away from the complacency. And ultimately, it comes down to death. If you're afraid of death, then you need to have that talk with Jesus. And you need to tell him, Jesus, I don't think that you actually rose from the grave. That's really what you're saying. If you fear death, you doubt Jesus. Jesus says in John 12, I am the resurrection and the life. Resurrection and the life. Yeah, you might physically die, but the Bible says to live is Christ, to die is gain. Automatically. That ought to take the fear from you. That ought to take the sting of death, 1 Corinthians 15, away from you. Now, what's the recourse? The recourse is that you are bold in your presentation of faith. You might not be articulate. You might not be good at doing it. But you need to be faithful because God will work through that. God will do stuff through that. And if your problems are the problems or they're the massive problems, you need to think about how big your God is. There's a lot of people who are going to be looking at unemployment. There's a lot of people who are going to be looking at dishonorable discharges. There's a lot of people who are going to lose health insurance. They'll get divided from their families. They'll lose their spouses. There's a lot of bad stuff to come. A lot of bad stuff to come because this spirit that's going on, it's priming everyone. It's programming everyone to accept the mark. Revelation 13, I don't think the vaccine is the mark of the beast. I don't think it is because us Christians are still here. We are the restraining force, 2 Thessalonians 2. When the Christians are gone, when we get raptured up out of this place, amen, Maranatha, let's go. When that happens, the world's going to be a free-for-all. And what do you think is going to happen? All these people that are lining up and subjecting themselves to the dictatorial arbitrary edicts of people who do not love Jesus, they'll do so again. So you need to get right with Jesus because I don't know what timelines are going on, but I know that God's the one in charge and he's the one that grants repentance. The way that he does that is by his church preaching the gospel to other people. You can solidify yourself, protect yourself financially. You can localize your assets. You can get involved locally. And those things are good politically. Those things are necessary, I think, culturally. We need to be able to do that to become more politically effective. But make no mistake, I am not here for you or me to be politically effective. I'm here to advance the kingdom of God by preaching the gospel shamelessly. And if any of this convicts you, then you need to go to your Bible. Get off the internet. If need be, stop listening to me and read the Bible. It's only after the church turns to God and is completely dependent on him and not government or our comforts or our conveniences that either this thing's going to turn around or we are in a position to prolong fight back as the church in Romans did, or we're going to be ripe and ready for Jesus to come claim his bride. This is the last time that I will broadcast on Facebook and YouTube, so I apologize for that. If that's an inconvenient, take this time to look at the links below. You can look at jaronjackson.com. You can enter your email there. We're reworking that. Going to try to make that more like a news blog type of thing to make that a one-stop shop. I appreciate you all watching. This is my job, ad-free. No one will ever tell me what to say. No one will ever tell me that I can't preach the gospel, and that's why it's largely ad-free. That's why it's corporate, no corporate money. If you want bullets, veteranammo.store is my ammo store. It's a subscription-based service. It's only 9 mil because you try to find components for any other type of munition right now. If you just want to be my boss straight up and say thank you for what I'm doing, or if what I do has value or entertainment or information or whatever, there's PayPal, Venmo. I would ask that you consider Subscribestar for 15 bucks, which is the same cost of Netflix. Get rid of Netflix. And, you know, you can chuck 15 bucks my way. Put that truth on autopilot. Appreciate your time as always. Things are good. Things are very good. We are in a fight. We are locked into a massive battle. But we already know God won on the cross. Once you start thinking like that, you can start to have your sense of humor. Once you have a sense of humor, you can start to recast and reframe the really horrible things into, God's going to burn that guy. That's a lot of how I make sense of things, is God's going to do a lot of burning. Because he said he is. Conscious, eternal torment, a lake of fire. I don't want that for anybody. Which is why I'd much rather tell these godless commies the gospel. Now, if we get them military tribunals, we'll give them due process, and we'll get justice. There's nothing wrong with justice, but we want to love them and preach them the gospel. I'm Jaron Jackson. I love America. Have a good weekend. I really want you to have a good weekend. Because I'm going to. I got weekend full of, what am I doing? Probably do a bonfire tomorrow, making scarecrows, because we got a hawk problem. Hawks are coming after our chickens, so I'm going to make scarecrows. So it's going to be a good weekend. I'm Jaron Jackson. I love America. Thank you for watching. Now go to war.